Yeah.
Yeah.
Nine. You are 9 or 10?
11.
Ah, 11, yeah. Okay. Yeah, so let me go back to what we were discussing. So we were discussing generalizing a little bit the framework of quantum mechanics to the case where we have the so-called pure state, which is what we were discussing all the time, right? Some given state of the system, and then this contains the as much information as we can, it can, so it is used to compute observables like expectation values of observables and the probabilities, right? We said that can also be expressed something like with a projector here, right? So this is the labels the eigenvalue of some observable. The probability that in a measurement we get this eigenvalue is given by this thing, right? Psi lambda n mod square, no? Which is the same as this. So this is so then there is some intrinsic probabilistic interpretation due to the fact that this is how quantum mechanics work. But we can have on top of that some other probability, which is in a sense is a classical probability, due to the fact that we have a partial knowledge of our system. That is, we know, for example, that the system can be in some set of states, and each of them appears with some probability, which I will denote again Pn. And so there is some state, say psi I, with probability pi, let's do like that, okay? And so this is what, so we are going to generalize this situation to this situation, so the sum over pi's, of course, is 1, and pi is between 1 and 0, right? And as I was saying, for simplicity, we can assume this state to be orthonormal, although it's not necessary. I mean, all the conclusions that we reach are equally true in case where these are not orthogonal to each other. Of course, they are normalized to, right, in the usual way. Sorry, I this one. So this this can be generalized by observing that we can write these things as traces, right? This is what we said. This can be written formally as the trace over the Hilbert space of this system, and with some quantity we call rho, A. A rho is nothing but a projector in this case. Rho is just psi psi. In this case, it is a projector. It projects on the state itself. And so rho square is equal to rho. Okay. And the same for this quantity, right? We can write this as trace rho pi n. Okay. So this allows, though, to generalize this situation to this more general situation. And so the what one does introduce that one introduces the density matrix, right? Which is some operator rho, we use the same notation, but now it's something like sum over pi, and we have psi i's. This situation, I of the set, okay? And this has this, the trace of this, of course, is trace rho is one, like in this case, also trace rho is equal to one. So this is true in both cases. But now this is not a projector anymore. Rho square is... There was some question? No. No, okay. Rho square is not equal to rho, right? Rho square is different from rho. And in fact, the trace of rho square is less than 1 because pi square appears. And pi square, since pi is less or equal than 1, generically will be less, right, than 1, the sum over. So this is what distinguishes a mixed density matrix, is this object. This describes what is called a mixed state, because it is a collection of more than one state. Okay? So this is the situation for the mixed state. And clearly, so we have, as I said, there are the probability due to the fact that we are in quantum mechanics, and the probability which is something which has nothing to do with quantum mechanics, is simply given by these numbers, pi's. And so now the expectation value of A contains, in some sense, two expectations, right? Because this is nothing but sum over pi, and then psi I, A psi I, right? This is what, right? So this is what we have in quantum mechanics, and then we average that over the various i's, okay? This comes from this fact, right? If you take the trace of rho, trace rho A, right? The usual story, you write sum over n, and then this is complete set, right? Psi I, pi, sum over n and I, right? And A, and this is n, so this is the trace, right? No, but then this is the same as the usual trick. Psi I, A, n, right? N, psi I, okay, and then this is the identity, sum over n, and so you get this thing. So, well, there are, I mean, okay, this is something which, this is not, is rather common in physics, right? And the example we were discussing was when we do quantum statistical mechanics. No? When we do statistical mechanics in the classical context, we have some probability distribution, right? And now we have, again, in the quantum case, some probability distribution which is encoded in the density matrix. And then there are additional probabilities due to the fact that we are in quantum mechanics. So we have two type of probabilities. Okay. So the example is the yeah?
Yeah, I was just gonna ask about an example where we use the mixed state matrices. Because yeah. I don't see where the external probability comes from. Like,
well, that is the one that we were discussing the other day. When we introduced the... Okay, let me go back to the example of the... When you do statistical mechanics, not only statistical mechanics, you can have physical situations where you cannot tell with what is the state of the theory. That can happen, right? You have a partial knowledge of the theory that can introduce. But where this enters also, importantly, is in the context of statistical mechanics. Now, when I define so-called these probabilities here, come through the Boltzmann weight, right? So you weight various states with what? E to the minus beta energy of the state, right? This is what the Boltzmann weight is, right? This is done also in classical case, right? The classical case, if you have a system with some number of degrees of freedom in some phase space, no? So classically, this is also what I discussed. We discuss a little bit the case where you have the collection of harmonic oscillator. This is a model for a solid, right? If you have a solid, you have the atoms, right? Let me draw the two-dimensional picture. Each side, there is an atom here, right? In this case, it's two-dimensional, you have to imagine the third direction like that, right? And they oscillate, right, around this equilibrium position, no? So on each side, there is a three-dimensional oscillator, right, because there are three directions. And then if there are n sides altogether, there are 3n harmonic oscillators, right? For the, okay. So this is a sort of model for the solid, and the particular to understand the specific heat of the solid. So in classically what you have some Hamiltonian in phase space, say position, momentum and position, right? I go from 1 to n, and the Boltzmann weight is what? Is e to the minus beta, say, let me call it rho again, e to the minus beta h pq, where pq are all the coordinates. This is some function of the space, phase space, right? And then, of course, you have to normalize it by the integral dp dq e to the minus beta h, because you want this to be, when you integrate it over the phase space, to be 1. If this has to be a probability density, right, better be 1 over when you integrate, like when you integrate the wave function over space, right? The total integral, the full integral is 1, is normalized to 1. So integral dp dq, dpi dqi, say from 1 to n, rho of pq better be 1. So then you can compute this probability density here, rho, p and q, to compute expectation values, like you do in, as I said, when you have a wave function in classical mechanics, you have the probability density, the modulus square of the wave function, and you can use it to compute average momentum, average position, and so on, right? But here, there is nothing quantum, right? It's just a classical, the way one does statistical mechanics, even in the classical case. So then this is used to compute average. Averages of observables, say A, is the integral dp dq. This will be function of A, P, and Q, rho of P, Q, right? This is very natural. This is classical. And now the example that I said is where this Hamiltonian is very simple. It's a sum of some number of 3n uncoupled harmonic oscillator Hamiltonians. H is sum over pi square over 2m. We assume the same masses plus m omega I omega square qi square, right? Again, the same frequency for all of them. This is the simplest case. And then if you plug this here, by the way, this thing here, this integral is the partition function. So this is very important. Z is defined to be dp dq, dpi dqi, product over I, e to the minus beta h is the partition function. It's called like that. Notice that here we have some given number of particles, n or 3n, but the energy is not unique, is not specified, right? The energy will come through averages like that, the energy of the system, right? So this is what one does in classical statistical mechanics, in the so-called canonical approach to statistical mechanics. Canonical means that the number of particles is fixed, but the energy is not fixed, and instead you introduce something which is conjugate to the energy, which is the temperature, right? Beta is 1 over k Boltzmann, this is Boltzmann's constant, kb, say, k times the temperature, T, okay? So here everything is a function of temperature. Okay. And the average, so in particular, if you want to compute the mean energy, the energy of the system, you just insert here the Hamiltonian, right? Which means simply taking, right, E, or H, is minus the derivative with respect to beta, log of Z, right? This log is the, you use the log because you want one over Z also, normalization, right? This factor here automatically comes if you use the log, right? So this is the most important quantity. Okay? And so, the most, yeah, this is what I say. In some sense, you, now we have here, you see, you have a continuum of degrees of freedom, right? Specified by PQ, phase space. Right? You have, unlike the case of quantum mechanics, where for the harmonic oscillator, we have a discrete, right? Discrete energy levels. Okay? Here you have the continuum, but, I mean, this is the probability assigned, say, to, you can think of sort of elementary cell in the phase space, right, is given by this density here, right? So then we can, okay, in this case we can compute this thing, right? It's very simple actually. You must have a computer there. This is KT, right? In this case, this case. Of course, I mean, not always you are able to compute this exactly, right? Depends on what is the Hamiltonian, right? It's a complicated integral in general, right? But in this case, it's simply, you do one, actually two Gaussian integrals for P and Q, and you raise to the power 3n, for example, right? That's all. So this is very simple. And this, I think, the classical case, right? Is KT if you have done it. So it's very simple, it grows linearly, it's linear in the temperature, right? If you plot here with the temperature here and E here, goes like that, right? The K governs this thing here. And so as you move down with T go to zero, it goes to zero. This is not surprising because if the temperature is zero, there is no oscillation. There is no, I mean, the particle is stuck at the sides, right? Of course, if you move now to the quantum case, what is the quantum case? Well, again, we use this Boltzmann weight, but now the Boltzmann weight is, say, in general, so the quantum. Boltzmann weight is again the same operator, say rho is e to the minus beta h, where h is the quantum Hamiltonian, whatever it is, divided by the trace of e to the minus beta h, right? The trace is the analog of making the integral over the full phase space. Now, this is a density operator. Why? Because, I mean, we didn't write this in the form, right? I said this is something pi, lambda i, right? Maybe you are confused by why this is of this form. Well, you just insert here the complete the identity in the energy levels, right? You can write this as e to the minus beta h, and then insert n. Sum over n and trace, right? I didn't do anything, but now this is the energy of this, right? Mod beta en, right? Right? So the p's are what? This divided by this, right? These are the P. Okay, now they are PNs because they refer to the energy levels. Okay. So it's very, it's completely. Now we have, of course, an infinite. In the case of a system with an infinite number of degrees of freedom, like the harmonic oscillator, not degrees of freedom, sorry, the energy levels, no, the energy levels are infinite, we'll have the sum over from zero to infinity. But you can even consider a system which has, say, consider the two level system that we studied at the beginning, it will have something similar. The only thing that will be just two states, two energy levels, right? E to the minus beta, say, for the two level case, you will have e to the minus beta, say, e plus, 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 plus e to the minus beta, e minus, 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 right? Over what? Rho. The trace of this, no? Which is e to the minus beta e plus plus e to the minus beta e minus. No? Normalized like that. Okay. For this is the simplest case, right? You have just two energy levels, and this is what it is. For the harmonic oscillator, this goes from zero to infinity because the energy level of the harmonic oscillator are at infinity. Okay. So it's very okay, really. So this fits in this general scheme. No? So here is this is Z. So this is what should do. Divide by Z again. The partition function is precisely the trace over the full Hilbert space of this operator e to the minus beta h. Okay. The same. Formally it goes through in the same way, and again, you know, the formula, this formula goes through in the quantum case because just a way taking the derivative with respect to beta is a way of bringing down h, right? In the expectation value. So this is what we do, and then okay. So this is the calculation, the classic calculation, the quantum calculation for the harmonic oscillator can be done, and we did it last time, right? You must have, I don't know what I asked you to do, to compare the two, right? But okay, Z is simple, right? Z is trace e to the minus beta h is nothing but sum over n of all the energy levels. Right? And then if you have a system of capital N or 3n harmonic oscillators, you take power 3n, that's all, because they are uncoupled. But the basic calculation is the one for the single harmonic oscillator. This is the partition function of a single harmonic oscillator. And you have just to do the sum, and we did it, right? This En is bar omega n plus half, right? So there is a constant term which you can take out. So this is e to the minus beta h bar omega divided by 2. No? And then there is a sum over n. This is a geometric series, no? This is what we observe. Is 1 minus e to the minus beta h bar omega, right? So this is the partition function. To the power, okay, whatever, 3n. No? And from this one can get the energy just by taking, say, E quantum, take minus d d beta log of Z quantum, right, of this. So now, what do we expect? This is what we are saying. We expected that the two agree, this and that agree in the large temperature limit,
yeah.
Right? Whereas they should show a sharp difference in behavior for t going to zero, right? In fact, if you compute, okay, one has to take the derivative of the log of this, okay, but qualitatively, what one, so if you this, you put the average energy.
The result is 3 and h squared omega over 2 into hyperbolic.
That is the, yeah, for the, first of all, there is 0 point energy, right? Mm-hmm. And then there is, yeah. So, okay, the classical case is this, right? And the quantum case, it goes like that, right? If you have done it. And this is where the 0 point energy is, right? So, indeed, and this is temperature. So for T large, they go the same way, and yeah. So let's see what was the precise formula. H bar omega, yeah, E was 3 H bar omega N over 2. This is the classical case plus, and then 3 N H bar omega, and then there is the 1 minus is this, right? Or, yeah, or the other way around, probably. If, okay, I can do it like that. I think it's like this, e to the beta h bar omega
minus one,
okay? So for as I said, for T large, what happens for T large, here, for T large, this is 1 over T, this becomes 1, right? So 1 minus 1 is 0, so this is dominating, right? So we should expand to the first order, right? And one finds precisely, because this is 1 plus beta h bar omega, right? Minus 1, right? This goes like that, and so beta h bar omega is it correct? This is there? No, probably didn't. Huh?
Yes, it's okay.
It's okay. So this is what gives beta is 1 over kT. So this gives the T up, no? And for h going to 0, this becomes big, the denominator, right? So this is negligible. And what remains is the 0 point energy. Well, it's a very clear physical picture. Actually, what one computes usually is the specific heat. The specific heat is the derivative of the mean energy with respect to the temperature, but it contains the same information. C is at constant volume is dE over dT. This is definition, specific heat. Okay, so one, this is something that can be observed physically, right? One, experimentally. Whether this behaves quantum mechanically or classically at very low temperature. Okay, this is one of the cases where this notion of density matrix appears in context of statistical mechanics, finite temperature system. Okay, and this is also this state, this particular state, we are calling state these objects, right? There are various names for this. This is called density matrix, also states, mixed state. In contrast with the pure state that we started from. So for this, when you define it through the Boltzmann way, it's also called the thermal state, for obvious reasons. Okay? This is also thermal state. It's a particular mixed state, which appears when one does systems at finite temperature. And it's defined through the Boltzmann weight in this way. Okay, but this need not be the case. I mean, there may be density matrices, as I said, simply for other reasons. Even if you are at zero temperature, there is no temperature, at least it's negligible, you may have still situations like that because you don't know, I mean, your state, you don't know what is your state. You can always say that there are some states appearing with probability. Yeah. And by the way, this row, what about, we are talking at fixed time, some given time, no? What about the time evolution? Well, the time evolution of this row is the usual one, is given by the usual time evolution due to the Hamiltonian is I h bar d rho dt is h bar rho. Okay, this is how the density matter. This is for both the pure and the mixed state. Okay. This is time evolution. Clearly, time evolution cannot transform a pure state into a mixed state or the other way around, right? So you cannot have, by time evolution, something like that, which is a pure state going to some mixed state, right?
Unless you have a black hole.
Unless, yeah, something happens. Okay. What is, I mean, this is something which I'm not an expert on it, but this now is becoming discussion about quantum mechanics. But what is supposed to, this is supposed to happen in the case, for example, suppose you make some measurement of an observer, you are in a state, this state, pure state, and you make measurements of an observable. Okay, what happens after you have done the measurement? Well, you can say that I know that if I make a measurement here, I can get, say, eigenvalues lambda i's of the observable with probabilities pi's, right? Pi, which are given by psi lambda I mod square. No? This is the interpretation, no? The probability of getting the eigenvalue lambda I of the observable A in the state psi is given by the modulo square of this thing. No? So you may say that after the measurement, you can describe your system by a density matrix of the form. Well, you have the probabilities here, rho becoming pi lambda I, lambda I. Right? Precisely. But a measurement, you know, is not an evolution, a unitary evolution given by some Hamiltonian, because measurement involves interacting with some external apparatus, right? So things become more complicated.
We can also do that on some of the particles. We measure one observable and some of the particles we measure another observable.
Yeah, okay. Now we describe something which is, yeah, which is fashionable these days for precisely relations to black holes, okay, which is the way to construct a mixed state from a pure state. And the way, one of the, the typical way is the following. Suppose you have a system which is a two non-interacting system, tensor probe, like we are doing, so say, we have many harmonic oscillators, they were not interacting with each other, okay? So how do you describe the system? is the tensor product, so you have some Hilbert space for one system, H1, or vector space, H2 for the other, right? And you have a state here, say I1 here. They are labeled, these are the labels of the eigens, some complete orthonormal basis for this. And here you have, I don't know, J, 2, to say that this is the system 2. See, suppose this has dimensions, I don't know, D1, this has dimensions, D2, okay. They may, D1 may be equal to D2, this is the example that we give. So, and so, now we have the tensor product of the two, say, vector spaces, okay, I use the letter H, but they think of ordinary vector spaces. Okay, and what is the basis for this? Well, it's the tensor product, right? So you take, say, I1 and J, 2, right? And there are how many of them? D1 times D2, right? Because this can go from 1 to D1, this can go from 1 to D2, right? Okay. This is a complete orthonormal basis. On H1 tensor H2, no? The simplest case you can think of the both being spin-half systems, in which case this is two-dimensional, this is two-dimensional, and this is four-dimensional, right? And now a general state in this combined system is a linear combination of this, right? This is tensor product here, okay? So psi is sum over some coefficients, Cij, right? And then I, 1, J, 2, no? Ij. Like this is. This is a pure state, eh? This is a pure state. Because it's just a state expanded in some orthonormal basis of this, this is H, in the Hilbert space H, which is tensor product of H1, H2. Okay. So the pure state is rho, the corresponding operator is rho, is psi, psi, right? As we define, right? You can use this to compute various things. I mean, there's nothing more than the usual story, right? Okay, but now what is you can do is take this operator. This is defined in the tensor product of these two. Right. Suppose you trace, take the trace of rho on the, say, Hilbert space H2. Okay. So what are you supposed to do? You take psi psi, and then here you take, the trace means that you have to sum, and here you take, say, I, 2i, right? And here I 2. Sum over I. Now this is what you trace over all only about this space. You could have chosen that. There is no. Okay. What is this? Well, we have to work out this thing here, right? This is what? We have to compute psi psi. What is psi psi? Okay, let's do it. This is sum. You have psi is Cij, right? I1, J2. This is psi. Sum over. The sum is outside. And then the bra will be C star, right? Say other indices Lm. I should have done before this, right? This should be like that. Let me, yeah. I 1, J 2, and this is C, I, J, okay? This is the cat, this one. Some over I, J understood, okay? And the bra is what? You have to take the complex, the Hermitian conjugate, right? So the C will be complex conjugated, yeah, C star. Let me introduce new indices Lm, and here is L1, M2, right? No? There are four sums, sum I, J, L, M. This is this, no? Rho. You agree? It's just, I mean, the only complication is the fact that we have two indices here, but this is because we have this. So we have to take the trace of rho over only the space 2, right? So this is Cij, C star, Ln. And now, so I have Ij, Ln, let me take the external state K. I have to take the matrix elements of here, K, 2, because the trace is over the space 2. Then this thing here, put it here, and then K, 2. No? Sum over K, the trace. Right? Now, what happens when K, you know, orthonormality, this gives delta Km, right? This with that, no? So there is a delta Km here from this, and here there is a delta Kj. So there is Ci. So Kj, we said, K, C, M is also K, C star, L K, no? And there is a sum over I, L, and K. And then what remains here? It remains, you have gotten rid of these two things, two guys, right? Only the one remains. So this is J1, I1, sorry. And this is L, I, and this is L1. Now we have only the space 1, okay? So this is a state in the system 1, right? Because we have gotten rid of this, right? Now, what is this thing here? So this is trace rho. Trace on the space 2 of rho is this thing here. Okay? What is this thing? If I introduce the matrix, capital C, with matrix element C I K to be C I K, I mean like that, okay. Matrix element are this, small C I K. This is nothing but C, and then C, then, you know, the matrix multiplication in this way. So this is C C dagger I M. So we have the trace of rho is equal to C C dagger IL, and here we have I1 L1, right? See, the key goes into the product of the two matrices, right? So written this way is like that. Okay? Now, what is this matrix here? It is an Hermitian matrix, right? Because CC dagger is Hermitian. CC dagger is Hermitian and positive definite, right? Because it's C times the Hermitian conjugate, right? So you see now, maybe, that...
Why is it positive definite?
Because it is a matrix times its Hermitian conjugate, right? It should have positive eigenvalues, right? We already used this. Suppose you can diagonalize each of them, then this will be the eigenvalues. Suppose you, I mean, this is more general than what I'm saying now, I should find the Forman proof, is the eigenvalue of this times the complex conjugate eigenvalues of, now this involves a complex conjugate eigenvalues of that, and so it's modulus square, right? But, well, simply take the matrix elements. Simply, if you have C operator C dagger, take matrix elements like that. This is always positive definite, right? Because this is nothing but C dagger psi. Okay. If you buy this, then you see that this is this thing here. What is it? C. Here. This thing here is nothing but a form of this, right? Because this is a Hermitian positive definite matrix. You can always diagonalize it, right? An Hermitian matrix can be diagonalized. And the eigenvalues will be non-negative numbers, right? Moreover, you can verify that, I mean, this will have norm between 0 and 1. So this is nothing but what I define to be a density matrix, right? Right?
For the subsystem.
Yeah, for the subsystem. So we start. So let me repeat what we did. We started from a system which is composed of two systems, okay, so the Hilbert space and tensor product. We constructed a general pure state for the composite system, which is this, nothing, there is no hypothesis here, it's just a most general thing, depends on CIJs. And then we traced this, we constructed the rho out of this. We took the trace over this Hilbert space 2. We could have done the Hilbert space 1, it would be the same story in the end. And in this gate, from a pure state, we go to a mixed state. Right? Which is of this form. The fact that, by the way, that this have norm between 0 and 1 is because, to begin with, this, the sum over modulus square of this must be equal to 1, right? Because this is a normalized thing. So this is a way of constructing from, yeah?
But it doesn't have exactly the same form, because there we have the same
This is what I'm saying. What about diagonalizing this matrix? If I go to a basis in which this is diagonal, right, then this becomes of that form, right? Yeah, in general this is not a diagonal matrix. I have to change basis. Okay, this is this kind of, you know.
Saying this because when you make the diagonals, then the only non-zero contributions will come when I is equal to
F,
both the states will become the same. And since the diagonal entries are positive eigenvalues, so the problem will be that positive, but it becomes.
Yeah, this is the precisely what I want to say. Yeah. So let me do an example of just the case where you have the H1, H2 are just two level systems, what we were doing, right? So you have for say plus 1, right, minus 1, and then the same for 2. Okay, I consider a state which is this. Psi is 1 over, I have to normalize it to 1, so this is say plus 1, what I want to do, to choose, plus, minus, minus 2, minus, I can do minus 1, sorry, plus 2. Okay? No, sorry, this is, this is a state of this form, right? It's normalized, psi is 1, because of the square root of 2 here, no? This is orthogonal to that, right? So you have the norm of this is 1/2 plus the norm of this is 1/2, so the total norm is 1, okay? So as this should be. And so if you take this, okay, let's do that, psi, this is 1 over 2. And then you have 1, minus 2, minus 1, and plus 2. This is the cat, and the bra is plus 1, minus 2, minus 1, plus 2, right? Okay, so taking the trace of this means that I have to take plus, say, 2, and minus 2, minus 2, no, this is what? Trace of rho is equal to this, no? Right? Yeah, 2. In this Hilbert space 2 or vector space 2, there are plus and minus orthogonal states, orthonormal states. Take one and the other, you sum. No? So, for example, this plus 2, okay, so what happens here? Plus 2 picks what? Picks this, right? If I take, so consider first this. This is 0. When you take plus, comma 2, this is minus, comma 2, is orthogonal, so it's 0, right? So this is 1/2, and this is minus 1. The minus here, and then plus 2, this is again minus, so this is plus, right? No? Are you following? I have to take the matrix elements of this between plus comma 2. Then I have to do the same thing for minus comma 2 and sum the two things. So this is the contribution of plus comma 2. Now let's look at minus comma 2. Okay? Gives this, only this contributes, because this is orthogonal, right? So this is plus, plus 1 half, minus, so plus 1, and here this is, and then you get plus 1, right? Everybody is with me? You have to ask, see if something is not clear. We repeat the calculation. Okay, let me ask you, is it clear what I'm doing here? I'm taking a state which is a linear combination of the basis elements of the vector space, which is the tensor product of the two vector spaces. For instance, this is just a choice, eh? It's not nothing special with that. So 1 and 2, 1 and 2, plus, minus, and then there's a minus sign, minus, plus. Okay, this is a very good, it's just a perfectly legitimate state of the system. Okay? And then I construct the rho, which is just this, and I get this thing, right? Just this, and then the bra. And then I take the matrix elements of this between plus, plus, and minus, minus, and do the sum. This is the trace over only the space 2, not 1. Okay? In the end, we get a state in the space 1, because, no? And this is this. But what is this? Is it a pure state for the space 1, or a mixed state? Huh? It's pure? This is, let me write in matrix notation. This is a projector. This is a projector on eigenvalue plus, say. Right? Which is, as a 2x2 matrix, is 1, 0, right? Think of plus and minus as 1, 0 and 0, 1, no? This is the projector on, and this is what? 0, 1. So the sum of the two is the identity, right? So this is 1 half times the identity. Right? Because this is the identity, no? Part of half is overall, right? This is a projector, this is a two-dimensional space, there are two projectors on one eigenspace and the other. The sum of the two is the identity, clear. Now, can this represent a pure state? Well, the trace, what about the trace? Trace is good. Trace is 1. But what about the trace of rho square?
Yes, it doesn't give 1.
It gives half, right? So this is not a pure state. It's proportional to the identity matrix. So this cannot be a pure state. In fact, if you this is the case of this two-level system, spin-up system. What happens if you use this rho, which is very simple, right? We have this rho is 1/2 1, 0, 0, 1, okay? If you use this rho to compute averages, We have a spin-up system. We have the three components of the spin, right? S. The spin is proportional to the Pauli matrices, right? Spin-up. And there are h bar over 2, because it's spin-off, eigenvalues must be h bar 2 and minus h bar 2. This is the correct normalization, and the spin has the dimension of an angular momentum, which is h bar. Okay, so this is the correct normalization. But okay, this is not very important. So if you compute in this state here, S, which is what? Is trace rho S, right? This is what it is. What do we get? Rho is the identity matrix, right? So these are Pauli matrices, they are traceless. So the trace are all zero. So you get that all the expectation values of S are zero. So this is a completely unpolarized situation, right? The state gives zero expectation value for all the spins, component of the spin. Now you may verify that, so this is something for you to check, there is no pure state psi, for which psi s psi is equal to zero. Okay. You may try to prove it. I mean, the way to prove is what? To write the more general state psi is a two-component vector and compute the values s1, s2, s3, or sx, sy, sz, and check that there is no way that this can be zero, all of them can be zero. So for a pure state, this cannot be true, never be true. However, for this particular mix, so this again is a, the way to get unpolarized situation where all the expectation value of the spin are zero is if you have a density matrix, which is a mixed state like that. Okay? Now, the last thing I want to discuss is the notion of entropy. Okay? Whenever there is a definition by von Neumann, which gives the expression for the entropy of the system in terms of the matrix of the density matrix rho, given a density matrix rho, he defines the entropy, von Neumann entropy, the trace rho and log rho. And actually, if you are in the thermal context, you put a minus k, but this is something that...
Could this also refer to the Shannon entropy?
So this trace rho of rho looks a bit weird, right? But you should think about this as simply saying you diagonalize rho, make it diagonal, and then the log of rho is just the log of the diagonal entries, right? And then rho is diagonal, then the trace is just the product of the two, and you sum. Okay? You should think like that.
If rho is not psi, rho is actually a matrix.
Mm.
So the log of rho is defined by the, you know, the
Taylor expansion. Yeah, okay, it's also that, but since, you know, rho is Hermitian always.
Okay, so it can be diagonalized.
Can be diagonalized, right? So this is a von Neumann entropy. Now, this is a kind of that you can use this to verify properties of the value states. The statement is that, let me make a few statements. For a pure state, S is equal to zero. Okay? So in some sense it's a test of whether a state is pure or not. You compute the entropy. Not obvious that it's always the simplest thing to do, but okay. Why is that? Well, you know, it's rather trivial, right? If you have a pure state, psi, this is a projector, right? So in some basis is what? Is 1, 0, right? You can choose psi as a basis element, right? So the projector on along the direction of psi is just given by 1 and the rest is 0, right? For example. Right? Now, it's clear that trace rho log rho is what? Well, rho is this. Now, log rho is a bit not well defined, let me write like that, but you know, log of 1 is 0, of course, log of 0 tends to be infinity, but on the other hand, you know, there is a rule, right? 0 log 0 is always 0, right? Because 0 wins, right? The log, right? So, for a pure state, this is always zero. The pure state carries no von Neumann entropy, which is kind of intuitive, right? Sort of entropy should be a measure of complexity of,
lack of information.
Yeah, lack of information. And this is true, right? Because the pure state contains the most information you can imagine, right? You know what is the state of the theory, right? So, okay, and on the other hand, so this state here, which is mixed, has a non-zero entropy because is rho is 1/2. And log of 1/2, right? So this is, and a minus, port on the minus. Forget about the k, set k equal to 1. Okay? This is nothing but log half is minus log 2, right? So this is essentially log 2. No? Because there are two. There is half and half, right? The minus cancels the minus for the half, so the sum is gives log 2, which is greater than 0, right? So this is a von Neumann entropy of a big state is positive.
If this entropy, you know, if it really behaves like the entropy that we study in, you know, statistical mechanics, then we can say that if we have a mixed state, the entropy will be non-zero. So the time evolution cannot bring it to a zero entropy state because the entropy will decrease that way.
Yeah, there are various. Yeah. And,
Well, if the system is interacting, maybe there is some way that the total has to be greater, right? So maybe the subsystem can have the lower entropy somehow.
This is also, for the example that we are discussing, I mean, constructing states from tracing over, so you have two systems, you trace over the one system, you get some, so you started with a pure state, which is for the full system, after you do the trace, you get a mixed state for the subsystem, right? It's also, this is what we are doing here, because we computed the entropy for that particular case, right? This is also called entanglement entropy. Okay? And this is a very active, I mean, this concept is, so, entanglement entropy is the entropy of a state which is defined in this way, I mean, after tracing a subsystem.
Probably for these kind of problems they use, you know, different definitions of entropy, like Rene entropy,
Hartley. Okay, I don't want to be, yeah, there are various things, but this is what it is. This is the entanglement entropy, and so is the sort of measure of the entanglement of the state, because the state that we started from, you know, plus say 1 minus 2 minus, this is 2. Then you have minus 1 plus 2, I think, something like this, okay. This is a pure state, there's no doubt about that. But, you know, the two systems here are kind of entangled, right? In the sense that if you compare this with a state like that, say, plus 1 and minus 2, this is also a state. This is psi 1, say. This is psi 2. This is also a good state, right? It's normalized to 1. But what is the difference between these two?
The first one cannot be separated into the...
Yeah, this is a so-called product state. No? Now, if you do the trace here, over here, like we did before for this, nothing happens. You get, what do you get for this state? You get, you trace over this, you get just that. Mm-hmm. No? Rho is just, in this case, rho is just plus 1, plus 1. In this case, so just a projector, whereas here we got, let me remind you, this was 1 half plus 1 plus 1 and then plus minus 1 minus 1, right? Okay, so this is not a pure state, this is a pure state. This has entropy, defined like that. This has no entropy. Entanglement entropy of this is zero because it's a pure state. Now, this became, well, this was known since probably early days of quantum mechanics. Now it's becoming this concept, I mean, this is very basic, nothing. Are studied in more complicated content in quantum field theory in connection with black holes and this kind of.
I think it has a connection with ELSTFP.
Yeah, all of that, yeah. All right. Particular, yeah, one of the the sort of breakthrough was to compute this entanglement entropy for a vacuum state in the quantum field theory. You know, these are finite-dimensional systems, right? But if you have a quantum field theory, you have infinitely many degrees of freedom, and then define this thing is not an easy thing to do. But this was done not very long time ago. So, yeah. So there is, okay, this is a definition. If you have a density matrix, you can define such an object, this is a von Neumann entropy. And this von Neumann entropy has, you know, can be applied in various contexts. One is this, which then becomes what is called entanglement entropy. But also in the context that we were discussing earlier, which is statistical mechanics, you can apply this definition, where now you put here the Boltzmann constant, this becomes the entropy, as one knows in statistical mechanics. to compute. Statistical mechanics, there is a relation. First of all, we define the energy, right? Is this is definition. This log z is related. There is another quantity. Let me remove this, which is the free energy, which is minus beta, I think, log z is denoted in this way. So if you wish, you could read it, z is e to the minus beta f. So f essentially is the logarithm of the partition function, or the partition function is the exponential of the free energy, okay? So there is E, F, and then you have the entropy. There is no relation between E, F, and S, which is, I think it's something like that. F is E minus T times S, right?
Yeah.
There is such a relation. That one can prove. Yeah. So this is well-known relation in statistical mechanics. Now, if you apply this definition to our rho, the thermal state rho, right? Rho was e to the minus beta h, right? Z. Okay. So trace rho log rho is what? Is e to the minus beta en over z, sum over n. This is rho. No? And then log of rho, e to the minus beta en over z. This is what it is, right? Sum over n is the trace. So the log here, this is what? This is the log of this, right? Minus the log of that. So this is minus beta en minus log of z, right? So this is S is minus k times this, no? According to the definition, there is a minus k here. Now you see that this term here, with that, gives the, is related to the average value of the energy, right? Because it's En, no? En, e to the minus beta En over z is the definition of E. The average value of the energy. So this gives, this term gives E, and what about this, right? This is, well, this is F, right? No. But this is 1, right? No, because by definition, right? Z is such a way that this is equal to 1. So then you have the first term gives E, the second term gives F, and the left hand side is related to S. No? So then if you trace correctly the factors, K, beta, and so on, you get this. So this definition of von Neumann entropy agrees in the thermal case with what we know to be the correct relation of entropy with energy, so free energy. This is the average energy, this is the T times the entropy. But as I said, this is used in various contexts depending on the information theory, there's the entanglement also. So it has various means, you know, in different contexts, but there's a kind of universal definition. Yeah?
We only talked about constructing pure states from, mixed states from pure states. Why not the inverse? Is it possible to...
There is something called purification. Yeah, there is something, I'm not very familiar with it. Yeah, there is
something. It's possible to...
I think so, there is some process called purification, which I guess would mean that if you take something which is not pure, you make it something which is pure, but I'm not very expert, I'm not an expert on this. Yeah. It's somehow, you know, my guess is that, like here, you know, you have a system which is a composite system, you trace over one of the two, and you get in the subsystem you get something which is mixed, not pure, right? Somehow you have to do the opposite, go in the opposite direction.
But I'm a little bit confused. If we do the opposite, the entropy will decrease.
Yeah, so but
the whole system might not. Because it's an interacting system, the whole may increase.
Yeah. No, I mean, I would say that the way to do it is you start from a system, introduce some copy of it, you know, you enlarge, I mean, do the opposite of what we did to get from a composite system, you trace over one of the two, you get something in one of the two subsystems which is mixed, okay? Now you can go in the opposite direction. Introduce a system, it seems a little bit fictitious, but I don't know if when people do say purification, they mean that. I can check this.
Probably it is more suitable for experimentation instead. Yeah. We need USA for that, and probably the one
to. All right. Yeah, yeah. Now let me try to remember, because I think you can always, also in the case of the thermal, you know, the thermal case, we have e to the minus beta en over z. This is a mixed state, right? Mm-hmm. I think you can, if you introduce another copy of the system, like two copies of the system, you can make it in that enlarged system to be pure. This can be done, yeah, I think so. I think this is, yeah. Is it called the quantum? Let me see. You have to do something like that, and then you have N1, N2. This is pure, right? Because it's a linear combination of, no? This is something like, let me call it psi. Now if you make psi psi, you see, if you make psi psi, first of all you get e to the minus beta en, because there are two, but then if you trace over one of the two, you recover precisely the something like that. I don't know if this is useful or not. Okay. So the thing to check is make sure that there is no pure state for which the system, spin-up system, is totally unpolarized. It's a little calculation. Thank you. You had something?
Ezt a panel is kérdezik.